22 minutes past 9 o'clock. Good evening, welcome along. You're listening to Monday Night's Monday Matters. What do you know about the Norman invasion? 1066, the Battle of Hastings, probably. That's about as much as I knew as well. See if we can find out a little bit more. He's on the phone, he's coming up next. It's Marc Morris. Let me start by saying that I have a problem with my next guest. No, not with him personally, but what he represents. In fact, it's not just me. The current government are wrestling with the same issue that I'm suffering from. Because what my guest, Marc Morris's book, called The Norman Conquest, does is show how inadequately I was taught the subject of history at school. Yes, I know that Henry VIII had six wives, some of whom lost their heads. And yes, okay, so I can recite the date 1066 and the Battle of Hastings. But should you dare to scratch a little bit deeper and test my knowledge on this subject, you'll find I have nothing else to say, especially on 1066. In fact, when preparing for this interview, I had to double check that it did actually refer to the Norman Conquests. My next question was, what exactly was the Norman Conquests? Here to answer that and talk about his new book is the author and historian Marc Morris, who specialises in the history of the Middle Ages. Good evening, Marc.
Good evening. Thanks for having me on.
Thanks for joining me. I'd hate to think that my listeners are as ill-informed as I am, but there might be one or two out there. So, for them and me, can you set the scene? Who were the Normans? Where did they come from? And what period in our history did they inhabit?
Okay, fundamentals. The Normans were a group of people who were based in Normandy, in northwestern France, which is obviously people in Kent will be very familiar with. They were somewhat different to the other peoples. We're talking about the central Middle Ages, really, sort of 10th and 11th centuries, at which point they differed to the other peoples in France in that they were originally Vikings. The word Normans is a contraction of Norsemen, men from the north who had settled, much as they settled in England in the 9th and 10th centuries, they'd settled on the other side of the channel in northwestern France. Unlike in England, whereas in England the Vikings were eventually driven out in the course of the 10th century, in the course of the 10th century in France they settled and stayed. And that's sort of where we get Normandy. It's a Viking colony. What happens with the Normans, though, is they very quickly abandon their Scandinavian heritage and become, in a sense, more French than the French. So they start adopting mounted warfare, they start adopting French attitudes, they start adopting the French language, they adopt Christianity, French forms of architecture, etc. So we are conquered in 1066, England is conquered, by a very particular kind of group of French people. They think of themselves as French, but at the same time not French, because they're conscious of their Viking ancestry.
Who were the sort of leading protagonists for the Normans, and what was their problem, I suppose, with the newly enthroned King Harold Godwinson?
Well, the Norman that you know everyone remembers from their school days is William the Conqueror,
yeah.
Duke William, who's Duke from 1035. And it wasn't so much a problem. I mean, the problem with Harold was that from the point of view of William and the Normans, they felt that Harold had a less good claim to the throne than William himself. And this is where historians today still disagree, as they're sort of looking at the nature of the claim. William claims that the King of England who died in 1066, Edward the Confessor, who'd been King of England for quite a long time by 11th century standards, since 1042, so he's had a 24-year reign, he claimed that Edward had promised him the throne sometime earlier in 1051, so he was basing his claim on nomination by the previous king. And Harold claimed exactly the same, but Harold claimed it at the last minute. He claimed that when Edward was dying, he told a different story, and then in his dying moments bequeathed the kingdom to Harold. Harold was the most powerful man in England, Earl of Wessex, and he and his family controlled much of the rest of England. They were the dominant sort of family or clan.
When we think about an invasion fleet, do we kind of know how, I mean, was he a wealthy man, William, and where would he get most of his men from?
Well, he was wealthy in as much, he was wealthy as 11th century rulers in what was then France go. Normandy was a wealthy province. But he's nothing like as wealthy or powerful as the King of England, as for sort of reasons I sort of outlined. England is much, much bigger than Normandy as it is today, and much, much wealthier, and much better organized and governed. That said, the Normans have perhaps a better track record during William's reign at aggressive warfare and recruiting armies, particularly recruiting cavalry forces. And when William sort of sets out to invade England in 1066, he's planning from January 1066, and he's recruiting mercenaries from sort of left, right, and center all over France, not just Normandy itself. Some of those men he'll be paying in advance, but in other respects, and this is where the Norman conquest does become a very mercenary campaign, is he's promising those men future reward. So he's saying, if you fight with me, if you come and help me recover my legitimate right, i.e. the crown of England, then I will, you know, I will give you enormous riches. You know, I'll make you all multi-millionaires, or the equivalent in modern money, overnight with what I'm able to give you once we've achieved this feat. I think the most we can say is what I say, sort of looking at figures in my book, is in the later Middle Ages, when we do have the figures, we know that no king of England, i.e. much more powerful men, in the later Middle Ages ever managed to get more than 10,000 men across the Channel in one go, one campaign. So William would have been doing well if he'd been able to match, never mind exceed, 10,000 men. So you're probably looking at somewhere between 5,000 and 10,000 men, and several hundred horses, perhaps running into four figures.
Because you touched on you touched on it there, that a lot of sources of information of the invasion come from the Bayeux Tapestry.
Well, some, yes, certainly.
Because I was going to say, I mean, that can give you the headline topics, but it can't be much good when you're trying to, say, write a book in detail about the invasion itself.
No.
What else? What other sources were you able to pull on?
Well, it depends on which side of the fence you sit. Early medievalists, people who do the sort of 8th, 9th, 10th centuries, will look at the 11th century and say, wow, what a sort of smorgasbord of riches you have. And people who cut their teeth on later centuries, 13th and 14th centuries, like I did, will look back and sort of just weep at the lack of evidence, you know, by contrast to those later centuries. You've got people writing histories at the time, contemporary histories of the Norman Conquest. So you've got monastic observers, monks writing chronicles or annals. So they can be very useful in England in particular. You've got the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle. And famously, in the case of post-conquest England, we have the Domesday Book, which is huge, astonishing survival, much like the tapestry. It's astonishing that you have a document that's 800 plus pages, 2 million plus words, but it is a difficult source to interpret. But that gives us a very strong sense of how much England had changed between its compilation in 1086 and the invasion 20 years earlier.
A book that William himself had obviously created after he had became king.
Yes, William orders the compilation of the Domesday Book at Christmas 1085, nearly 20 years into his reign. The thing that's so frustrating, I mean, Domesday is a wonderful source, we'd be hugely impoverished without it, but the frustrating thing about the Domesday Book is, for all its size and the vast amount of data it contains, no one knows precisely why it was compiled. It was compiled in a situation of sort of a imminent invasion crisis from Denmark. But why, you know, the sort of thinking behind it, was it to overhaul the tax system? Was it to find out precisely where all the new Norman landowners held their lands? There's an ongoing debate with historians, you know, even a century or more after serious scholarship on it had started. So it was one of the more complicated chapters in the book, put it that way.
You're listening to 106.9 SFM. Jason McCrossan here with Monday Matters, and I've currently got Marc Morris on the other end of the phone. He's written a book, it's called The Norman Conquests, and he's talking to me about it. So, the Duke of Normandy, William the Conqueror, lands in Pevensey on the 26th of September. I'm guessing that Sky News weren't there to cover it. So, how would news reach King Harald? Was he expecting it? Was he prepared for it?
I think the sort of conventional answer is that, that seems to have grown up in the last 50 years or so, is that Harald was certainly expecting invasion from Normandy, because, you know, it's sort of writ large in all the sources, and also in his actions, in that he summons a great army of his own and stations it all the way along the southeastern coast from the Isle of Wight all the way along to Kent, where we are. And it's held in readiness throughout the whole summer, so from late May right the way through until early September. And then, because at that point you have to get the crops in, and there's only a certain amount of time that people are expected to serve in a volunteer army, he has to disband it around the start of September. And again, this is sort of well-known politics that people might remember from their school days. At almost precisely that moment, he is hit with an unexpected invasion, which is his brother Tostig in league with the King of Norway, Harald Hardrada. So there's a sort of third contender weighs in unexpectedly in early September 1066. Now that does, and contrary to sort of modern scholarship, take him by surprise. You can tell that partly because, as I say, he's massed all his resources on the south coast in expectation of Norman invasion. And also we have chronicle accounts that indicate it was unexpected. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle describes the Norwegian fleet as landing unexpectedly. With the Norman invasion, by contrast, in late September, I think he's anticipating it throughout the summer. He probably hopes, having beaten the Norwegians in Yorkshire in September, he probably hopes that that's the last he'll hear of the Normans, that it's got too late in the season, that William won't be able to hold his troops together much longer. And then at some point, soon after he's defeated the Norwegians, a messenger arrives and says, the Normans have landed at Pevensey.
That's right, because he had been, as you said, engaged in those battles leading up to October 1066. Do you think that because he was engaged in other battles, when it came to the Battle of Hastings, these troops weren't as fresh, let's just say, as the Normans were?
Well, it depends whether he's got the same troops, you see. You read a lot in sort of like popular histories of the Conquest about Harold, and the sort of people are always kind of keen to sort of praise the underdog, and you'll get all this stuff about Harold, how he's impressively marched his troops very quickly hither and yon. Now, that's certainly the case when he sort of rapidly reassembles his army to take on the Norwegians. And he does take the Norwegians by surprise, and it's a great victory. And had nothing further happened, we would all now probably be talking, you know, about sort of what a great sort of successful military leader Harold was. But I think probably at that point, having beaten the Norwegians and having heard nothing from Normandy, he must disband those troops. You don't keep, you know, troops sort of together once you've defeated your enemy. So I think probably once again he's faced, when he hears the news in Yorkshire of the Norman landing, he has to sort of hoof it down to London as quickly as possible and raise a new army. Now, whilst he's kind of got lots of manpower resources, they're not infinite. So if lots of people have perished, as we believe they did in those engagements, then he's sort of, yes, you're right, he's got less troops to draw upon. But what really does for Harold, it seems, is he sort of throws himself into battle too quickly. You know, it might be whether it's sort of hubris or whether he's just thinks that he can play the same trick again, i.e. sort of surprise the Normans before they're ready. All the sources, both Norman and English, indicate that he sort of shot down to the Hastings area without waiting for enough troops to come up. And, you know, the battle that follows, the sort of the blunder from Harold's point of view, or you want to put it that strongly, is that Harold doesn't need an outright victory. Harold just needs a draw. Harold just needs to keep the Normans at bay, because they suffer all the disadvantages of an invading army, i.e. they've got a limited amount of resources. In order to get more resources, they'll have to spread out and forage, at which point they make themselves vulnerable. Whereas Harold is the crowned king, he's got people on his side, so he can get away with a draw. I mean, instead, he throws himself into a direct engagement at the earliest possible opportunity and loses.
So Harold's dead. William the Conqueror, I should say, is it anointed in Christmas
Day?
Yeah,
when you're crowned, you get the whole business in the Middle Ages. Your anointing is actually the bit that makes you king. Crowning is, you get anointed, crowned, the whole bit, yeah.
On Christmas Day. If I was, and your book actually talks about the wholesale rebuilding of every major church and the total destruction of an ancient ruling class. Yeah. If I was living in a little village in the heart of Yorkshire, what would be the main difference I'd experience to my way of life maybe 2 to 5 years after William has been made king?
Well, I suppose the question immediately to fire back at you is, did you choose Yorkshire there at random, or are you thinking of Yorkshire in particular?
At random.
Okay, well, I mean, if we take anywhere in England, north, your experience, there is a sort of an argument, a continuous argument, saying, well, it's just the substitution of one ruling class by another, so it's a few thousand people at the top, and for most people, probably the life went on much as it had done in the past, and the grass still came up green every year, etc. But I think that's to kind of really underestimate the massive impact of the conquest. Firstly, it was a hugely traumatic event to replace the whole ruling class, actually down to quite a low level, if you sort of if you're defining it as an elite replacing another elite. We know that there's probably 7,000 or 8,000 Norman lords in place where there had been Englishmen. The thing for quantifying this is Doomsday Book. If you look at Doomsday Book, the wonderful thing about Doomsday Book is it tells you the situation as it was on the eve of the conquest, 1066, and then it asks the question, and what's it worth now? What's, you know, what are the sort of the assets mm-hmm. of the estate in 1086? And what you can see is that in that generation, that period of 20 years, the aristocracy of Anglo-Saxon England has been completely swept away, right down to the level of your local village. So in every village and hamlet in England, you're going to have a new Norman lord, where you'd once had an Englishman. And so you also got castles being built in their hundreds to sort of enforce this military takeover.
So and had there not been that many castles previously to then?
There have been virtually zero. It's not, you could say, you know, England before 1066 had been a land without castles. There are a tiny handful built in the Welsh Marches by some Norman friends of Edward the Confessor. But prior to that point, no, nothing. Nothing that can be reasonably described as a castle. And then you've got the land, I mean, this is the sort of the lament in all the English sources, is he built castles and had the poor people oppressed. So you do get that sense from immediately after 1066 of England is now a colonial society. If you think of England as being like any of the societies that Britain went on to conquer in the early modern period, like, say, India, England is in that position of having military takeover had happened, and the English themselves now are a sort of subservient race in their own kingdom. So, enormous. I mean, the other thing you mentioned, of course, you mentioned Yorkshire at random, yes. But Yorkshire is one of those places that suffers perhaps more than any other place in England, because William finds it particularly difficult to retain control over lands north of the River Humber. You've got sort of an Anglo-Danish society there, and you have, from 1069, you have Viking armies invading and supporting English rebellions. And after three rebellions in Yorkshire between 1068 and 1070, William decides that he's had enough, and if he can't hold the land, he will make sure that nobody else can hold it. And the result is the infamous harrying of the north, where he just destroys everything that can sustain human or animal life north of the River Humber, burning crops, killing animals, not particularly targeting people, but making sure they're not going to survive the coming winter. And if you look in Doomsday Book there, you can see the drop in the number of people, the number of people that vanish in Doomsday Book, is something in the order of six figures. So we're looking at maybe 100,000 people perishing in Yorkshire alone. So, you know, this is what we would consider a war crime in sort of 20th, 21st century terms. Not so much in 11th century terms, but nevertheless, contemporaries did recognise that this, the scale of this devastation was something else.
It's 106.9 SFM. I'm Jason McCrossan, and I'm joined on the line at the moment with Marc Morris. Marc has a book out, and it's called The Norman Conquests. Few people have shaped the history of our country, but William the Conqueror really changed everything, the language, the laws, the architecture. Do you think he should go down as one of the most important, if not the most important, person to influence our history today?
I don't see particularly the need to kind of
glorify
that sort of thing. You get, well, not glorify certainly, but I've never felt the need to sort of put kings in rank order and say, oh, the best king, the greatest king. I certainly wouldn't go anywhere near praising William the Conqueror. I mean, the contemporary opinion on him was split up the middle depending on which side you were on. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle has some good positive things to say about him in terms of his the strength of his rule, the peace he maintained, etc., but also a long litany of bad points about his rule, you know, the human suffering, the amount of tax he took, the castle building in particular comes up, his introduction of the royal forest. This is, again, something that the Normans bring, which is new. But in terms of, as a historian, I'm not sort of interested in handing out sort of, you know, hero biscuits and sort of, you know, who's wrong, who's right, who's the worst king, who's the bad king. What excites me, has always excited me as a historian, is change. You know, if everything stays the same, then it makes for a boring book. But I don't think there's a comparable point, any point in the last 2,000 years in England, where you can say, this is where history massively sped up, you know. And the Norman Conquest, you say, changes everything in terms of military technology, architecture, language, law, the aristocracy. You know, it's sweeping, seismic social change. And it was one of the things I really wanted to get through in the course of the book, because there are any number of small sort of Henry's histories about 1066 that dwell on who was right, who was wrong, who got an arrow in the eye, how many numbers at Hastings. But to sort of unpack the significance of the date, the thing that, that you find people don't remember from their school days is why. Why do you remember 1066? It's because of all this sweeping social change.
The Norman Conquest is published by Windmill Books and available on Amazon. Marc Morris has a website, a useful useful website, for more information about the books and himself, www.markmorris.org.uk. Mark, thank you very much for joining me this evening.
No, Joe, it's been a pleasure. Thanks a lot.
Local radio for Sittingbourne, 106.9 SFM. Don't forget, if you want to keep up to date on everything Sittingbourne, check out the 106.9 SFM website at www.sfmradio.com.
She once had